Hello and welcome to UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers Barber, Director for the Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College, and your host. 100 days of the Trump administration, with only 1,360 more to come in Donald Trump's first term as President of the United States. Questions. Do we know enough after only 100 days to confidently preview what can be expected during the balance of his first term? Or will the events of the day shape him into the president desired by his party, confirm what was predicted by the loyal opposition, or produce a leader that may be opposed based on policy, but respected because of his stewardship while in office? Joining me to probe these and other questions surrounding the Trump presidency is a distinguished scholar and colleague, Dr. Julianne Malveaux, President Emerita of Bennett College for Women. Dr. Malveaux is an economist, author, and commentator whose popular writings have appeared in USA Today, Black Issues in Higher Education, Ms. Magazine, Essence Magazine, The Progressive, and many more. Dr. Malveaux has held leadership and board positions in women's civil rights, policy, and public service organizations. Currently, she serves on the boards of the Economic Policy Institute and the Black Doctoral Network. Dr. Malveaux is also president of Push Excel, the educational branch of the Rainbow Push Coalition. Her most recent book is Are We Better Off? Race, Obama, and Public Policy. And her latest project is It's Personal with Dr. J, a podcast available on iTunes where Dr. Malveaux riffs off the feminist slogan, the personal is political. Welcome to UDC Forum.
Well, Cedric, good to be here. Thanks for having me.
It is an interesting time, and one of the things that we're going to talk about is this presidency that's new and you're laughing right off. It's new for many reasons. The first time we've had a president without any political experience, and certainly who's bringing a new perspective to this office.
That's a very kind way of putting it.
What are your comments first on the election? How did he get to the Oval?
Two things. Number one, it's very rare that a party holds the White House for a third term. President Obama had two terms, so it was very likely that we would switch. Secondly, he talked about hope and change, just as President Obama did in 2008. Now, the hope and change he talked about was a different hope and change, but that's so people who wanted a change went there. Thirdly, he had a highly coded racial message. Now, I'm not going to say that everybody who voted for 45, and we don't call his name, let's just call him 45, but everybody who voted for 45 is a racist. But what I would say is that he had a highly racially coded message. And some people say it wasn't even coded. When you call Mexicans, you know, rapists, when you go into a white community to scold black people, that's not coded. But in any case, what I'm concerned about is the fact that Hillary Clinton, who was my candidate, I worked very hard for her, did not do the best campaign she could have done. Let's break it down. Fewer than 100,000 votes in simply three states, Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, would have made the difference. Fewer than 100,000 votes. Meanwhile, Secretary Clinton did not campaign heavily in Wisconsin, did not have a huge presence in Detroit, and did not have a huge presence in inner city Philadelphia. You know, it's all water under the bridge now. We have what we have, but I laughed with your intro when you said we only have 3,660 days. And I'm like, what damage can be done in 1,360 days? And, you know, we see damage every day. And the challenge is that we can't, you know, let's not drink the Kool-Aid. Let's not go with the okey-doke. As we are sitting here talking about trivial stuff, we don't know the answers about Russia, and that's really one of the biggest issues. Every single day, 45 is changing some of the Obama executive orders, especially around worker protections, but also in other areas, environmental protections. And so, you know, people who you know, people have been very agitated. We've seen women, and I was there, out on the Women's March. We've seen people out for environmental justice. We've seen people rallying for science. Mm. Let's not forget that the way that we flip the script is in 2018.
One of the things that you talked about, the coded message, but the population that voted for Trump, and it's a mixed population. We aren't going to say everybody was had right. malicious thoughts against, you know, minorities or anything of that nature. But what was it that he managed to get from people who didn't have those intentions and who weren't malicious? What were they seeing?
Number one, they were seeing change. President Obama did a great job of getting us out of a horrible recession, but the recovery did not trickle down. So if you're Sandra Jowers, who hasn't had a raise in 5 years, mm-hmm. you've managed to hold on to your job, but you know all these people who haven't held on to theirs. You haven't had a raise in 5 years. You're hearing economic recovery, but you ain't feeling it. You maybe like Hillary, maybe don't like Hillary, but you're like, yeah, I'd like to see something different. Mm. That's one of the things that was going on. A lot of people held their nose and voted for 45. They didn't think he was all that, but they thought, I don't want to go on the way we've been going on. So that's one of the things I think that was attractive to people. What I saw the 2016 election as a triumph of predatory capitalism that was wrapped up mm-hmm. in populism. In other words, predatory capitalism deals with power and resources going to the top. And we've seen that with the increasing amount of economic power that the 1% have. Mm-hmm. In the last economic recovery, I'll give you contrast. In the economic recovery that occurred in the 1960s, the bottom 80% got about 70% of the recovery benefits, where the top 10% got the rest. Now, the last recovery, the one we're in now, the bottom 80% lost 15%, while the top 10% gained 115%. So predatory capitalism concentrates power in the hands of a very few. That's what Donald Trump really said when he was running for office. But he packaged it in a populist set of rhetoric, which said, I'm gonna take care of your coal jobs. I'm gonna create jobs. I'm gonna create more jobs than you ever had. You've never seen, you know, more adjectives invented like bigly. Have you ever heard the word bigly? But you've seen all these adjectives invented, but the point was that he was able to signal to the capitalists, I got your back, but also signal to the working people, I got your back. You can't have both people's backs. But the working people were the ones who felt aggrieved by President Obama for two reasons. One, I think, was race. But I think the other was that they did not see the terms and conditions of their life change. So if you're given a contrast, I'm gonna keep going the way we've been going, or I'm gonna shake this sucker up and give you new results. What do? If you're not discerning. And I think one of the challenges that many of us have is that we can't talk down to these people. They're smart people. You know, we disagree with them, but they're smart people. So when we start talking about them as being racist or being cray-cray, we further marginalize them. The conversation that we who are progressive or radical or the Bernie camp or in the Elizabeth Warren camp need to have is, what did you miss? Because here's what we know is going on, Sandra. When you look at the Department of Labor, it's experiencing a significant cut in its funding, which means that we'll have fewer people monitoring occupational safety and health mm-hmm. violations. Working class people work in places where you have occupational safety and health violations. So you just voted to cut your own throat, to make it okay for that to occur. We have a piece of legislation that President Obama or executive order before It was 23,000. If you made more than $23,000, you couldn't earn overtime. You were considered an executive. Now, you and I and everybody else who's listening knows that $23,000 is not an executive. President Obama posited that the number should go up to roughly 46,000. There have been two suits in circuit courts to say, no, we don't want to do that. Alexander Acosta, who is President 45's nominee for Secretary of Labor, says he will follow the president's lead in that. And he said, well, the number might be lower, I'm not sure. The minimum wage. 45's first nomination to the Labor Department was a gentleman who didn't believe in an increase in the minimum wage. So, and people think about the minimum wage and they dismiss it. They say, well, it's just kids. No, two-thirds of the people who earn the minimum wage are over 18 years old. Many of them are women who had households. And so, you know, we can go into that, we can do a deep drill into that, but let's not. Let's simply say that the people who 45 promised to help are the people who are going to get kicked in the teeth. We've already seen it with the resistance to the Affordable Care Act. Because people called it Obamacare, it became a proxy for what people felt about President Obama. But feel what you will about President Obama, the fact is that this was landmark legislation. And let's just take it to another level. Even people who did not like President Obama were gratified when they found that their 24-year-old student son or daughter, who was going to be charged $1,000 by their college for health care, could instead stay on their health care bill. People who had pre-existing conditions, who found that, you know, because they were diabetic or because they had a heart condition or something, that they were being excluded from health care, now found that they had to be included. And they were like, excuse me, but I'm, you know, whatever I think about President Obama, I want my benefits. It's very difficult in our country to unring the bell, to take a benefit back from people. So what President Obama did is he pushed the safety net. He expanded the safety net to include 20 million more people, including 3 million more African Americans, for health care. Now, was it everybody? No. Would I prefer single payer? Yes. Is the Affordable Care Act flawed? Yes, but it's better than what we had in 2007. So let's give President Obama credit for that, and let's chide 45 and his colleagues about this notion of repeal and replace. Once you repeal, you've got people sitting out there. And so what do you replace it with? They have not been able to figure that out. Now, as we move into Congress's back from their break, you know, maybe they'll come up with something, but I predict that not only vulnerable Republicans, but Republicans with conscience, perhaps an endangered species, will hear from their constituents who will say, I think I kind of like the Affordable Care Act. And the coupling, the uncoupling is, when you started calling things Obamacare, all the crazy white people, and all the crazy white people who didn't like Obama said, we don't like that. But you remember the piece that I think was Bill Maher, one of the late night comedians did, where they said, how do you think about Obamacare? And they're like, I hate it, I hate it. What do you think about the Affordable Care Act? I love it, I love it. What was the same thing? Yeah.
What do you think happened? Well, some of we know what happened the first 100 days when the first thing he wanted to do was repeal the Affordable Care Act and found out that it wasn't as easy as that, and that there was this flood of people saying, okay, we really want this. And his own party, the internal strife that occurred over that. How do you think that eternal conflict or internal conflict is going to impact what he wants to do in terms of repealing what President Obama's legislation and some of the landmark pieces?
Well, there's so many things that are going to happen as we see the continuum of ideological focus among Republicans. You've got that Tea Party, what do they call themselves, the Freedom Caucus group. They want to cut the size of government. They want to change the way taxation works. And they're pretty adamant. Then you have, again, an endangered species, but you have some moderate Republicans who are not prepared to throw the baby out with the bathwater. They haven't sat under their tent to have the conversation that says, this is what we're going to do. And so even now, initially, as Congress was coming back, 45 said he was not going to sign a budget agreement unless it included funding for the wall. And of course, this was a wall that he was going to make the Mexicans pay for, but now he thinks that U.S. taxpayers should pay for. Well, as things evolved, you found that that whole issue receded, and he said, okay, we're going to take that off the table. So I predict that he'll be taking a lot of things off the table as he attempts to figure out how to manage his own party. Here's the challenge. He really is not a conservative Republican, but he plays one on TV. and so you've got a gentleman who has given money to the Clintons, he's been all over the place. I bet if you combed his records, he may have given money to Planned Parenthood. I'm not so sure. His daughter and his son-in-law are more moderate than the rest of his cabinet. And so he has to figure out how to manage this. The good news is that he has galvanized Democrats and galvanized the opposition to really examine him closely, to begin to organize for 2018, to in selected congressional districts where you have replacements, such as in Georgia and Kansas, to look at how you can begin to take back the House from a Democratic perspective. That's the good news. But the bad news for Democrats, but perhaps the good news for the country, is that maybe he's learning something. I mean, what he's done heretofore has not worked. So if he's as smart as he tells us that he is, and I'm not sure about that, eventually you learn. You know what your grandma said? You put your hand on the stove one time and, you know, you got burnt. Will you do it another time? Well, he's done it about 20 times, but what I think he's seeing is that some of these tactics that may have worked well as an entrepreneur or as a reality show star don't work so well as a president.
The galvanization for the Democratic Party should involve some self-reflection. You had mentioned earlier about some of the things that Senator Clinton did not do and some of the places she should have gone where she didn't go. What do you think some of the things are for the Democratic Party so there can be a change in 2018 and 2020?
Well, I think the move to have Tom Perez and former Secretary of Labor Tom Perez and Congressman Keith Ellison to co-lead the party as DNC leader and vice leader, I think was a really brilliant move. I think that having cut Congressman Ellison out would have sent the wrong signal. Perez won, but narrowly. It was not an overwhelming, and so basically you have someone or a team trying to bring the two wings of the party together. I've been excited to see Nina Turner, former state official, I'm not sure what her position, but state official from Ohio, you know, now part of the commentariat and, you know, just very, very focused and really outstanding. But Democrats are going to have a conversation, which has not been held. Part of the conversation that white Democrats do not want to have is the race conversation. And we saw in the wake of the 2016 election, people saying, well, there's too much identity politics. Well, but there is identity politics. You can scrub me till you're blue in the face and I'm still black. And you can, that just saying to me, I don't want to talk about identity politics, doesn't work. In fact, many of the challenges the African American community faces are challenges we face whether 45 or Hillary were president. I think that obviously Hillary would have been better disposed to deal with some of our challenges, but the 2-to-1 black-white unemployment ratio has been there since the 1950s. And no president has ever said, it's going to be my goal to change this. Let's even make it 1.5. We've not seen that kind of thing. So the race conversation is important. The immigration conversation is important. The women conversation is important. And I think that because Democrats do this big tent progressive thing, they've been able to avoid difficult conversations. But I think that Bernie Sanders and our millennials have pushed the point and especially Bernie. I mean, I wrote a piece back in maybe February of 2016 called Head Hillary, Heart Bernie. You know, I was with Hillary, I mean, for any number of reasons. But Bernie was talking what we needed to hear. And it's too bad that he waited until late June to get on the bandwagon. And it's too bad that her team didn't really reach out to him sooner and include some of his rhetoric in what she was talking about. I can't wait to read this book, Shattered, that talks about her campaign. Mm. But we all know some aspects of it and know that it was not a great campaign. There were great people, but not a great campaign. So back to your question and to your point, what are Democrats going to do? We're going to have the conversation that we've been avoiding, quite frankly, since 1984 when Reverend Jesse Jackson ran as Democratic nominee for president.
The immigration issue is certainly one of the key issues, and President Trump was saying that was one of the things he was going to tackle as well. He's had some setback with some of those executive orders banning people coming in. He's gotten pushback from cities who declared themselves sanctuary cities. How do you think that's going to, what has he learned that's going to change going forward?
Well, I hope he's learned that he's not a dictator because he's behaved that way. And the two executive orders have been orders that have the courts have challenged for any number of reasons. Of course, he has Gorsuch on now on the Supreme Court. So if those appellate court decisions go up, he's likely to be affirmed. But I think he hopefully he's learned, number one, that he's not a dictator. Number two, I think that the whole, especially along the border where he would like to build fences, what we know is that there's a culture that is very intertwined and interdependent. Mm. That you have people who have property on both sides of what would be the wall. So how are they going to get back and forth from their property? And yeah, there's still issues, and you still have people who are, you know, coming across the border, and a lot of people who live on the border are saying, you know, I come out to my clothesline and my clothes are gone, and they left me their clothes because, you know, that's what's happening, or people filled up their water sacks with my well. So there are issues, but I don't think that the hard line works, and I hope that the president has looked at people's reaction to it. Then you look at California and Texas, and you look at population in those two states, and what you see is a growing Latino population, and California and Texas actually used to be Mexico, not to mention New Mexico, but anyway. So you see people who are fully participating in civic life, who are working, who are in jobs that nobody else wants. Let's just say that. Mm-hmm. Who are working in jobs. So, you know, there's a subtext that a lot of African Americans have of, well, they're taking our jobs. Well, I'm sitting and saying, okay, so how many of y'all gonna really pick grapes? Y'all know y'all not gonna pick grapes. So, you know, just tell the truth. So, you know, but you have people who are fully integrated into the economic life of this country. And the question is, what happens if they disappear? I mean, we really have to deal with that. What happens if they disappear? And so I think that, you know, President Obama, with the Gang of Eight, tried immigration reform. But Sandra, I worked for President Carter. This, of course, dates me, but I ain't ashamed. I'm 63. But I was on the junior staff of the Council of Economic Advisors in the 70s, in the late 70s. And Ray Marshall, who at the time was the Secretary of Labor, at that time, proposed immigration reform. So we've been over and over and over again with this issue. And the fact is that when you have different economic conditions in contiguous countries, you're going to have people who are going to be pulled over because they can improve themselves economically, even if they see themselves as coming for 2 years and sending the money back or doing whatever. So we have to figure out a way to manage that without being hateful, without being xenophobic, and without telling lies. And the lie is that, you know, we're taking people are taking people's jobs. Again, I think we look at the H-1B visa, that's a whole other story, but if we look at agricultural work in California and Texas, people are not lining up for that work.
And I think that's part of it too. I think there's a lack of knowledge of what people actually do. When people understand some of the jobs, like you're right, who is picking grapes? I'm
you know, brothers are not standing up and sisters
are not going out to pick race. But I think there's a lack of knowledge about that. But you had mentioned Bernie Sanders and you mentioned the millennials. They're going to be critical,
very
I think.
Very much so.
And so what are some of the issues that you see that they may have, talking about identity politics? I'm a firm believer, it's all identity politics. What is important to you? How are you identifying with what's going forward? But we're looking at millennials who did not have some of the advantages, and we're the same date group.
Don't worry about it. Yeah.
Who didn't have the opportunities, who went to school, who went to the Harvards and the MITs and the Howards, but now they don't have the opportunities. The jobs aren't there. They're still living with their parents. And maybe they don't want to be, but they're still there. Thank goodness for the Affordable Care Act. But what do you think is driving their engines?
Well, I think there are a few things. First of all, the millennials, if you define them as demographers do, are from 19 to 35. So there are a lot of subgroups in there. The 19-year-old is still in college. The 35-year-old is maybe married or trying to get married or trying to start their family. So it's a continuum, as every generation is, baby boom, et cetera. Number one, when we began to cut education, we stopped teaching civics in high schools. So while I would not say that this generation doesn't know enough about civic engagement, because that would seem to be condescending, I would certainly say that the formal introduction to civic participation does not exist. So I had conversations with millennials around the 2016 election where people said things like, well, I'm just not excited about Hillary. And I would say to them, well, you know what? I've been voting since 1972. Mm-hmm. And I was excited about Jesse Jackson in 1984, 1988. And I was excited about Barack Obama in 2008 and 2012, even though I didn't agree with him by 12, but I still was excited. Who could get excited about John Kerry or Jimmy Carter or some of these people? So it's not about being excited, but they seem to translate their support into excitement. So one of the things that I think is important when we talk about the millennial generation is to really talk about how we teach civic engagement, which is why I really enjoy the Black Lives Matter movement and those young people. I think they're really doing some of that. I don't think they're doing enough of the education piece, but I think that their presence really pulls people in. When DeRay, the young brother from Baltimore, ran for mayor,
yes.
I think it's McKesson, DeRay, and he got about 4,000 votes. I think he pulled young people to the polls. But this generation is the rising generation, which will be the larger generation, which will really dwarf us as the baby boom. And so they're going to be making public policy. And so they need to understand, and we need to understand what makes people's temperatures rise. And when we think about some of that, one of the things we have to think about is that this generation has been ill-served by our economy. More and more of them have huge amounts of student loan debt. They follow the rules that say go to college, but they took on the debt. So what are we going to do about that? And what are these people, average age 65 in the United States Congress, going to do for a generation that's 19 to 35? And then what are they going to do to us? You know, I mean, I always think about it, like, okay, what are they going to do to us? But seriously, the millennials deserve to be heard. They deserve to be able to put their ideas out there. There are lots of them who are playing in the big sandbox with, elders. You call some of their names, like DeRay, like Simone Sanders, who was working with Bernie as his spokesperson. And he really did bring in a lot of young people, young Black people, which unfortunately we didn't see as much of on the Democratic side. And that's really gonna be a challenge. We have to be excited about them. We have to be excited for them. We have to enable them.
We're going to take a break and be back with more conversation with my guest, Dr. Julianne Malveaux.
One of the issues that I have particular interest in is mentoring women of color. A lot of the research in higher education has looked at issues with men, particularly African American men, and their persistence to graduation from college. But the data support that young women, particularly minority women, are at greater risk for dropping out of school, and if they leave school, the likelihood that they will return is much lower than the likelihood of a minority male's return to school. So we really have to do some concrete and sustainable kinds of efforts around shoring up our most vulnerable college students. And while we've spent a lot of time looking at men and minority men, the data support that minority women are probably at greater risk, not of getting to college. They'll get to college probably in higher number, but they're at greater risk of completing.
Welcome back to UDC Forum. My guest is Dr. Julianne Malveaux. Dr. Malveaux, we had talked about the millennials and some of the challenges they face in terms of the heavy scholarship loan debt, and the economy is difficult for buying houses. How is that going to shape their perspective?
I think that the millennials will be far more, many of the millennials, not all, will be far more progressive about economic justice, about how things are distributed, about what their opportunities are. I'm hopeful that they'll look at banking regulation and other regulation and see how there are potentials for exploitation. Mm. I think that as you talk to many millennials who had been standing at the sidelines, Bernie Sanders really brought them closer into the political spectrum. Now, I'm not sure what that means, and we'll have to see how it plays out, but I think that many of them are really look askance at traditional Democratic politics. What we do know, not only with millennials but in general, is that the largest party really is a non-party. Mm. Is that independents are greater in size than either Democrats or Republicans. And people, while they have principles and ideas, can be swayed either way. I'm what I call myself a yellow dog Democrat. If it's a yellow dog and it's a Democrat, I'm a vote for them. I mean, you probably have to cut my fingers off 1/8 of an inch at a time to get me to vote for a Republican. That's just, you know, how I came up and how I was raised. There are a lot of us who are yellow dog Democrats.
Right. Yeah.
But I don't think that the millennial generation is that party loyal. I think that they're more likely to look at, basically the nuances. Mm-hmm. One of the places that we see this, Sandra, is in the whole school choice issue, and we've seen lots of op-eds back and forth. And I've pulled back, I write about it a little bit, but I don't have kids, I have neither chick nor child. And so I'm not making a decision of, is my child gonna go to a public school that's failing or a private school that's doing okay? Now that really is not the dichotomy, but that's how conservatives will pose it. The fact is that there is no research that suggests that charter schools are better than public schools. You have a continuum on either side. You have really great public schools, you've got really great charter schools, you've got really horrible public schools and really horrible charter schools. And in the middle, you have that average thing. But I think that many millennials, especially if they have children, mm-hmm. are saying, you know, I want to pick what's right for my kid. And I don't blame anybody for that, but what does it mean for the social fabric? And this is one of the places where millennials are prepared to look at the nuances. And many of us who are public school advocates, et cetera, are more didactically wedded to our position. And this is where there's a room and opportunity, I think, for dialogue.
Talking about education, let's talk about the Department of Education's the reception here in the District of Columbia, the initial reception was one of resistance. Parents protested, teachers protested. She was unable to enter the first set of schools, Betsy DeVos, that she wanted.
You mean Betsy Devoid of good sense?
She was unable to enter the schools. What, and her part, she's definitely charter school. That's very much her preference, and she makes no bones about it. And How is that going to be impactful if you've got a Secretary of Education and you have a president who initially wanted to get rid of the Department of Education? What is going on here?
Well, we have a real challenge. The Department of Education is going to have I'm not sure the number, I believe it's about a 13 or 14% cut. But inside that cut is also a set aside of about $1.4 billion for charter and private schools. So you're gonna be taking money out of the public school system and putting it in charter and private schools, even as you're cutting the entire budget of the Department of Education. Betsy DeVoid, I just call her DeVoid, after her W.B. Du Bois debacle and many other debacles, it's just questionable about why 45 chose her to be Secretary of Education, unless it was simply to dismantle our public education system. But in any case, what we know is that here in the district, in New Orleans and other places, federal policy has pushed charter and private education over public education. Mm-hmm. I think this is problematic in the short run and in the long run. In the very short run, private and charter schools get to pick their students. They're cherry picking. They're picking the best students. They're not going to pick baby boy who has a behavioral problem. Baby boy with a behavioral problem who requires more resources because he has a behavioral problem is going to be at the public school. And then you're going to say the public school failed because baby boy don't know how to act. So the public schools, when you empower charter schools and do not require them to be more broad in their acceptance policies, the public schools become the dumping ground. And then they're judged by being the dumping ground. Even though we have great students, there was just a piece about Eastern High School and the number of young people who are taking international baccalaureate and passing 50%. Yeah. I mean, that was just such an inspirational piece. So we really do see a war on public education. The other piece of the public education war is the fact that public education was not only a function of providing education, but also a function of dealing with social issues, how people mix with other people. So when you see young people, and I've seen many, who have been homeschooled, they have not been exposed to almost anything. They get up in the morning and they work with their mama. Maybe they go to the National Museum of African American Heritage and Culture. I mean, they may be white, they may be black, they do that. They go to the Smithsonian for something else. But where are they interacting with other young people? And so what does that mean when they go to college, but more importantly, when they begin to interact in society? See, I think that racists are two kinds of people. One are people who are mentally ill, and Dylann Roof is mentally ill. But others are people who have not been exposed, who don't know. So if they know that we all bleed the same kind of blood, that we all kind of love the same way. Who we love is who we love, and we're very loyal to that. That we read with the same eyes, you know, that we walk with the same legs. But if you haven't been exposed, it's easy for you to then create a narrative that says, these are not people, these are different than. And so I'm concerned about those schools that create narrow white occasions, that create cloistered environments. I'm concerned about that. And I think that DeVoid will push that as opposed to looking at the small e ecumenical nature of public education.
One of the other challenges is the self-segregation that goes on. A lot of times between students, and maybe it's because of not having exposure, not understanding, or not being in an environment where there are different kinds of people to interact with. What do you say to individuals who want to have single-sex schools, who are... who are promoting schools for boys and schools for girls and using the social issues as a foundation for that? Because of what society thinks about young black men, because of what society thinks about young black girls.
Well, you know, as a former president of a women's college, like I said, you got me on that one. But what I would say is that we have to look at pathways and patterns and ladders and lattices. When the Citadel, one of the challenges with the Citadel, and I remember writing a lot about the Citadel back in the 80s, and one of the challenges was that the Citadel was a place where, having graduated from the Citadel, gave you a leg up in career development and advancement in South Carolina and indeed nationally. So why should women be excluded from a place where you got a leg up? And that became part of the conversation. Women, I just actually met a woman who was a professor of history at the Citadel, fascinating. Younger white woman who is hoping to get tenure at the Citadel. And I'm like, really? But in any case, you've seen the integration at the Citadel by gender, and you've seen many women gain. I think that when I look at Bennett and Spelman Colleges, the two HBCUs that are focused on women, I think it's important for women to have a space. And I think that many women, unfortunately, because we live in a world of patriarchy, cut and paste themselves for men. So if a sister does not have to worry about having three layers of eyelashes on before going to school, before going to class, and she just put jeans on, put a t-shirt on, go to class and learn, I think that's a good thing. At the same time, then why would I oppose a West Point? And so maybe you got my hypocrisy there. So I'm, you know, something I'm playing out, but the question is what the ladders are. And what we know is that women who go to single-sex schools are more likely to do leadership, more likely to accomplish, because they're often and continually affirmed. And oftentimes, and that's again an argument for HBCUs, where people are continually affirmed, whereas in more integrated settings, not so. Men are always affirmed wherever they go. They're just always affirmed. I mean, you know, I've been in settings where young men who are working in the mailroom as interns think they could be the CEO. And we'll almost say, I could do that. And you're like, dude, no, you really couldn't. Whereas young women sit and say, oh, I'm so lucky that I got this opportunity. Yeah. Just the way that society affirms us. At the high school level, I think, and we clearly it's an issue here in DC and nationally, if we're prepared to create spaces that are all boys, and there may be arguments you can make about that, let's create parallel spaces that are all girls and use the same amount of dollars to do that and create opportunities for young people by gender to also interact with each other. We don't want some boy or girl to have their first real interaction being at 18. Right. So we have to figure out what curriculum looks like. But I stand firmly that women's colleges are important. And I stand firmly that when men's colleges, whether you have single-sex education for men, that leads to employment opportunities that women don't have, then we need to look at how we change those. If I'm a hypocrite, I'll be one.
You said a term that we certainly have to discuss. You said HBCUs.
Yes.
A lot of attention on those HBCU presidents that met with the president. A lot of controversy on campuses, and I'm sure in boardrooms, pro and con. What is your feeling on that meeting? Should it have taken place? Should they have gone?
Well, people ask me that all the time. Had I been the president of Bennett at the time, I would have gone to the meeting. The president of the United States is the president of the United States, no matter what you think about him. Would I have gone to the photo op? Oh, hell no. The meeting should have been impactful and important. From what I understand from many of my friends who were in the room, they were meeting with cabinet secretaries when suddenly someone comes in and says, let's go do a photo op. So the substance was basically hijacked for the photo op. Now let's talk about photo ops. You and I have been in these settings where you have photo ops. If you and I are sitting together and someone takes a picture of us, that's a photo op for both of us. We go put it on our wall. We're gonna say, I'm with the esteemed Dr. Jowers. You're gonna say you're with the esteemed Dr. Malveaux, and that's gonna go on our wall and we're gonna be happy. Now, if we go up in a room and there are 50 people and somewhere we're there, that's not a photo op for anybody. But if I'm sitting in the middle of the room and I say, here I am with all the people who support me, that's a photo op for me. It's not a photo op for y'all. So that was a photo op for 45. It was not a photo op for those presidents. And some of them handled it very well by slipping away between the meeting and the photo op, because the photo op was Pimp City, as far as I'm concerned. HBCU presidents were pimped. But the meeting itself had the potential to be substantive. I'm not sure that it was. Some of my colleagues, former colleagues, say that it was. Some say it wasn't. I'm not sure. But here's what I do know. An executive order was signed, as executive orders have been signed every time a president comes in. No dollars were put behind the executive order, which is what the expectation was, is that there would be dollars. There were no dollars. In addition, when we saw the budget from the Department of Education, we saw that the HBCU line was not cut, but things that impacted HBCUs, such as the summer Pell, were cut. So are we better off or worse off? I would say until the budget is approved, budget light says worse off. So all these people spent their college's money to jump up here to meet with whomever, and I don't see the takeaway. But you know, this 100-day thing is artificial as far as I'm concerned. Let's see what happens when we get to the budget process. Who's gonna stand up? I know that Congressman Clyburn, Congressman Cummings, those who have been supporting HBCUs, they're gonna stand up. And so maybe we'll eke out a few more dollars.
The appointments that he's made, let's talk a little bit about who is now around the table, or who is in the cabinet. What do you see shaping the cabinet? I mean, just looking at it externally without knowing anything, it looks, of course, very white, very rich.
And very male.
And very male. That's
so you got a bunch. This is, again, the triumph of predatory capitalism. You have a bunch of old white capitalists whose job has been heretofore to maximize profits, whose job has been heretofore to figure out, as the case of Rex Tillerson, how to make sure that ExxonMobil made the most money it can, no matter what that meant to Sandra Jowers or any other individual who was attempting to deal with issues of energy. So you basically have put the fox in charge of the hen house. And this is very challenging. And there has been no apology, no context, no discussion. Why am I appointing this person? So except for Elaine Chao, who is now at Transportation, who used to be at Labor, who heretofore has been a moderate Republican, but of course is the spouse of Mitch McConnell, so one never knows. But for her, and you've got these basically rich white men, who are, and Betsy DeVos, who is a rich white woman, who is also connected to rich white men in terms of her brother, her father, et cetera, the source of her wealth. You've got a bunch of folks who are dedicated to the principles of predatory capitalism, deregulation and concentration of power, the minimization of worker and people protections. So how do you cut the EPA by 31%, cutting out 3,200 jobs? Footnote, 29% of the federal employees are what? African American women. So, but that's just a footnote, main thing. So you're basically giving people license to pollute. You're giving people license to essentially not only our rivers, but also our airspace. And you've given a person who sued the EPA the authority to run the EPA. How does that make sense to anybody?
And that's part of the dichotomy of this. People, and I'm wondering if that base that elected him, are they sitting around the table saying, oh my God?
No. There was a CNN Wall Street Journal poll that was done the weekend of April 21st, 22nd. Only 2% of Trump voters regret their vote. Only 2%. So they haven't seen it come down on them yet. I mean, they haven't seen what's coming. They haven't seen what's happening. Only 2% regret their vote, according to this particular poll. Now, I find that fascinating, but I also find it is what it is.
J. John Spicer, not the first name John, what's the first
Sean
name?
Sean Spicer.
Sean Spicer, yeah. Oh, yeah. Pardon me. Sean Spicer.
Melissa McCarthy.
That's her retirement, okay? Mm. That skit that she does, she's set
for life.
For life, for that.
For life.
When he verbally attacked April Ryan, the way he addresses the press, the whole concept with the press, and we can put the African-American woman in there because that seemed to be personal, but I'll leave that alone. So what is going on with the press and the way the presidency seems to view the press?
Well, I think, I'm gonna do this. I think the president and Sean Spicer are playing the press like, you know, they're playing the press because people are so interested in these stupid press conferences. Let me say, stupid press conferences that very frequently do not give up new information, but ignoring what's going on in terms of, again, Russia. Can we get to the bottom of this?
That's my next
question. There's so many other things that we need to get to the bottom of. He has signed executive orders that have rolled back Obama initiatives. Can we get to the bottom of this? Everybody is, you know, Sean Spicer is, I find him quite amusing. And I'm wondering, I'm so sorry that St. Elizabeth's in Washington has been closed down because obviously they would have a suite for him there. There's something going on. And it wasn't just April Ryan. I mean, we all looked at it because April, of course, is a sister and we didn't like the way he spoke to her and he was very condescending. But he's been condescending to just about everybody. He doesn't know how to talk to people. But apparently 45 likes him. 45 thinks that he gets good ratings. And this, we reduced the government of the United States into a ratings war, which is crazy. So when we look at the relationship with the press, I think that too many of us who call ourselves press are interested in the short run and not the long run. I think too many people are interested in what's happening right this minute as opposed to what are the implications. I think that people have pressure from their editors to come up with the next scoop. And I think that some of this nonsense, I mean, why does Omarosa quarreling with April turn into news? Mm. I mean, this is, you know, junior high school, which should not be on grown people's TV. But so I think that people are obviously under pressure. The news organizations are looking for ratings. They're looking for who got the next story. And I think that we see very little of the long run. We have yet to see the comprehensive piece about what's going on with Russia.
That's the question. Let's talk about Russia. Some of the facts that have been revealed, the interactions between cabinet members and Russian officials, mm-hmm. and yeah. some of the exchanges and some of the overlap that appeared between the campaign and even after the campaign. But then you see President Trump doing something, taking a position that's apparently anti-Russia's interests. What is that relationship? It seemed to be a bromance initially. What's going on?
Well, first of all, I think that if we expect consistency from 45, that we're delusional. I mean, I think that this is an entirely emotion-driven administration, that when he gets mad or he sees pictures of the Syrian children, all of a sudden, I'm going to go send 59 Tomahawk missiles after them. But these are the same Syrian children that you don't want to let into the country. Number one, we need to know more about 45's taxes and his financial relationships with Russia, which many people say, I have no inside knowledge, there is a relationship. Clearly, Jared Kushner, his son-in-law, met with Russian bankers before 45 was installed. So we know that there's some things going on. These people are using the United States as their personal piggy bank. I mean, Ivanka sits next to Chinese ambassador. Next thing you know, she gets all her the patents that she wants. So who else is she going to sit next to? But no, going back to Russia, we just need to know. We need to know, and we don't know. And clearly, I think that 45 behaves like he has oppositional personality disorder, like a spoiled brat. So the status quo does not like Russia. He likes Russia, you know. But all of a sudden, when clearly the Syria situation comes up and he's gotten, you know, some responses from the generals, he has to look at it again and say, well, maybe not. But we're not dealing with someone who has policy. We're not dealing with anything but these pop-off reactions. And that's the point, is that, you know, he is a firecracker. You know, this is nothing stern and steady about this. Maybe he'll grow and learn. Certainly some of these international issues have to give him pause as we find ourselves oppositionally situated with not three, but maybe four countries. And we don't have the military firepower to deal with any of that. But meanwhile, back at the ranch, the Russia situation is one that should concern all of us. And we can't. I mean, let's just give a shout out to Maxine Waters, who has simply not taken her eyes off the prize. But meanwhile, back at the ranch, so many of us, I mean, myself included, from time to time, have gotten involved in the strum and drang of the crazy nonsense that's happening without saying, we want to know what role Russia had in our election. We want to know what our president's financial ties are, not only to Russia, but to other countries where you want a tax plan. How do you benefit from it? And this is why heretofore, even John Kerry, who was extremely wealthy, you know, people say, well, people weren't that wealthy, but John Kerry was wealthy. You put it in a blind trust, you do something, you don't touch it. No, these are limited trusts that his family has. And we're paying for those two Trump young men to run around the world. We're paying for their security. If they're making profits, they need to pay us back. Ivanka does not need to be inside the White House, but if she's there, she needs to get rid of her company. But she said, well, but I'm, you know, the trademark. Okay, so the United States is now the trademark for the Trump family. And I think Cummings and Waters that focused on Russia, because I think uncracking that nut probably tells it all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Malveaux. If you want to know more about Dr. Malveaux, visit her website at www.juliannemalveaux.com. If you are interested in learning more about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. And to learn more about the many certificate, training, and degree programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.